Okay, so that's kind of the crux of the entire story. The conclusions and next steps I have for you are, what are the trends? So this is not a very entrenched field in pharma. This is something which is probably kind of gaining momentum, I would say. So here, if you look at PubMed mentions of QSP, there's a lot more coming up over the past few years. When you do surveys of pharma companies, more and more companies are interested in developing these mechanistic physiological models. What can we do with them? So it's that way, it's a very exciting field. As a lot of you have quantitative backgrounds, as engineers, how is it interesting? Because you, why are engineers useful? You want to have a systematic approach to problem solving. You want to understand key aspects of the problem, make clear definitions, and then transfer it to mathematics and be comfortable with running models, writing code, optimizing, using statistical methods, etc., just to kind of live at the intersection of where quantitative stuff and biology meets. So that's where we are most useful for drug development. Scientifically, there's a lot of excitement in the field. I think because the field is young, there are a lot of standards that we need to develop for the field, and there's a potential impact of people joining the field. We want to make sure there are ways to quantify the uncertainty from these models, like standard ways to develop the models, etc. Even more interesting, we talked about multiple scales. I didn't talk a lot about genomic data. Integrating genomic data to mechanism is a big problem, and it's a challenging and not solved. And using quantitative techniques to kind of bridge that gap is another big thing. When you think of what we spoke about, which is trying to synthesize data from hundreds and thousands of papers to get the state of the art into a model. So far, it's a very time consuming process, and a lot of us have to read these papers to get this together. There's a lot of potential to have machine learning, natural language processing techniques to come up with these crystallized ideas so that that can become a lot faster. So there are a lot of interesting problems in this field. Culturally, one of the things that you guys are still in college, but as you have to learn, is in the real world, a lot of interesting things happen only when people from different backgrounds sit together and try to solve problems. So culturally, pharmaceutical industry as well as biomedical research is obviously been dominated by people who understand the biology, who understand lab work, etc. And integrating quantitative methods is relatively new. And there's a lot of opportunity to kind of be part of that culture, and that requires something from the engineers as well. We need to make sure we understand the biology and understand enough of the detail to make useful models. So there's a lot of scientific and cultural challenge as well. Okay, so I think that's basically it. Any questions?
So in the complex networks that you mentioned, where there were like several nodes and all, so were those networks like inclusive of molecular components and cellular components as well?
In the diabetes model I mentioned, very often not molecular. Okay. So we only go as far as some cellular path. Yeah. So maybe there are some enzymes and proteins, but not single molecule type stuff. Just how do proteins interact across cells? So that's usually the level, but you can have QSP models which are intracellular signaling. So once there is a signal comes in, what is the signal transduction within a cell? There are a whole class of models like that.
So in the beginning, when you were talking about drug development, you talked about how to integrate this and how to find out whether how does it percolate to the entire population.
Correct.
So can you make that out by just looking at a QSP model, or do you?
So it depends on the level of detail that you're asking the question. So for instance, the diabetes example we had, you can just say insulin increases flow from the plasma to the muscle. So that is one level of detail. That can help you when you're trying to recreate a clinical trial, when you're trying to understand some data, when you're trying to understand how much to dose. But suppose the customer or the pharma company has a drug which increases the amount of receptors in that arrow, then that model is not sufficient. You need to go into one level of detail deeper and say, now I'm going to model the receptors, the ligands, the intracellular signaling and such, and then ask, develop a model with that degree of detail, do that perturbation and see what happens. So really what I spoke about today is kind of a gross, large level model of glucose and insulin, but the model you want to develop should answer the question that you're interested in. Does that make sense? Yeah. In general, I think when you think of a QSP model, what you're really thinking of is something that spans scales, you know, goes from like cellular level to organ level to clinical level. Ideally, we want some clinical level, but if not, you know, definitely span those levels so that you're able to integrate a lot of knowledge. No, in fact, there are acute and chronic effects. I think chronically, it may induce people to actually store more and eat more and things like that. Acutely, I'm not really very clear what happens. Definitely, your point is correct that lipids are another source of energy for the body. So anytime glucose is low, you metabolize lipids to be used. But the problem with hypoglycemia is that it's an extreme and your brain can't use lipids. Your brain still has to use glucose. So the only compromise is the brain, the lipids can get converted to something called ketones, which can be used by the brain, but not for the long term. So hypoglycemia is to be avoided at all costs. So that's definitely the thing.
You mentioned about the variability, right?
Mm-hmm.
So some patients might respond, and your model has to some way account for it. So while doing that, do you consider like what part portion of the population is the way this particular kind of response is seen more?
Yeah, so you're right. Maybe this is where you're going and tell me if I'm helping, but it's possible that diabetes has many subpopulations. So some people are diabetic because their pancreas is just not secreting enough insulin. It's become very weak. Other people are diabetic because there's too much fat deposited in their muscle. So when these signals come, it's not reading it that clearly. So you may need different treatments for those two, and the same treatment may not work for those two. So that kind of analysis of subpopulations, we definitely do with parameters. It has to be guided by the data and hypotheses like this.
Is there a genetic basis to diabetes? Like, can it be inherited?
There have been a lot of what they call these GWAS type studies. So when in the 90s, the big promise was once you figure out what's in your DNA, once we figure out your genome, then we'll be able to tell for sure what diseases you're going to get. That works in single, you know, when there are single nucleotide changes. So when there are some diseases which are driven by small changes, yes, that you can tell. You can test a fetus and say this kid is probably going to be sick with this disease. But diseases like diabetes, autoimmune diseases tend to be multifactorial. So you know, there may be a lot of genetic variation that predisposes you or makes you more susceptible than some other people. But not everybody with that profile is definitely going to get diabetes, and not everybody who doesn't have that profile is guaranteed not to have diabetes. So that kind of demarcation based on genetic data is not available for the more complex diseases. It's possible if we have data from tens of millions of people and we have better quantitative techniques, it's possible that we can come up with a risk number. Based on your genome, you're 90% going to get diabetes. Based on your genome, there's only 10% chance. Even at the end of the day, these diseases, there has to be an interaction between lifestyle and gene. So it's, you know, there's studies actually in obesity where immigrants to first world countries, they get obese, they get metabolic diseases, but their cousins who stayed back don't get those diseases. So genetically, these are very similar people, but they behave very differently because of the environments that they're in. Most complex diseases, there is going to be a part of the environment. But to your point, I don't think we still have a test to say that your risk is X percent with any degree of confidence. Again, there was a promise that will help us identify targets. So you can see the chain of thought, right? So if I find what is wrong in the genome of a diabetic person, that means I know what proteins are not doing well. Once I know what proteins are not doing well, that can be a drug target I can go after. But I feel like in the last few decades, that's not quite played out like that. I think this targeted drug identification has not worked as well as we thought, and part of it is the data is maybe too sparse, maybe the biology is more complex than we thought it was. So, and what works for some people doesn't work for other people. So, that's the way that a drug can't be generally successful. So, that promise of going from GWAS to drug, I don't think that's worked for any particular drug in these kind of diseases. The one place it has worked is cancer. So there's, you know, if you have a certain type of breast cancer, there's a drug that you can get, which is almost a 90% cure for you. But that means that you have to take a biopsy, make sure that you have that particular mutation, so that that Avastin can, or I forget the name, that works for you. So that kind of stuff exists, but for the more complex lifestyle plus gene diseases, we don't have a slam dunk case for to go from one end to the other.
So I hope through these series of videos you have had a good introduction to quantitative systems pharmacology and how drug development and modeling are helpful in the pharmaceutical industry. And in the next video, I'll be back, wherein we talk about constraint-based approaches to model biological systems. I'll introduce you to constraint-based approaches. We'll talk a little bit about what are the constraints that pervade biological systems, and also the all-important concept of the stoichiometric matrix, which is central to all of our next few lectures.